We'll also talk some swimming this evening with Highland coach Mike Boscovich. He's in our studio tonight. He will be the first of two studio guests this evening. There was plenty of basketball last night at Purdue Calumet. The women's team beat Valparaiso. We'll show you highlights of that one. The men's team was also victorious. They beat Indiana Tech. Head coach Larry Little is with us tonight in the studio, and we'll get to him a little bit later in the program. But as always, we start you off with boys high school basketball. And the folks who make up the ratings will see it as an upset. 16th ranked Wallace over 9th ranked East Chicago Roosevelt. Now those who were at the game saw the strength and intimidation of the Lew Wallace Hornets on the inside. Brian Asbury and Tellus Frank, along with the outside shooting of Wallace's Renee Glover, he finished with 19 points. Let's go to the tape. The final score was 73-65 Lew Wallace. We pick it up, of course, in the first quarter. Art Pollard gets a jumper to here, and that made it 6-4 East Chicago Roosevelt. Tellus Franks, he's 6'9". He's here on the baseline, and we're all tied up at 6 apiece. Now, Frank popped for 10 points in the first half. He was Lew Wallace's main source of offense. He hit two straight. Lew Wallace led 10-8. At the end of one, it was the Hornets, 17-14. Brian Asbury came up with a rejection. Johnny Fort gets the slam, and the Hornets led 33-20. Now we'll go back to Art Pollard. He hit two straight, and it cut the gap to 32-24. Let's show you number 44 on the inside for Lew Wallace, the reverse. That's Brian Asbury. Let's go to the paint with Jerome Battle. And at the half, Lew Wallace led 36-29. Now number 22, Jerome Battle, hit the first two baskets of the second half. And that gave the Wallace Hornets, or that cut the Wallace lead to 5 points. Now we're going to go, here we go, here we start the second half. Number 22 is Jerome Battle, as I said. That cut the Wallace lead to 5. Now we'll go off the glass. Number 25 is Art Pollard, and the Rough Riders are within 2. Renee Glover on the jumper, it's 49-44 Lew Wallace. Richard Randolph with the rebound in the basket. Wallace led 55-51 going into the final stanza. Now Brian, or that's Tellus Franks, number 41. He gets the bucket to make it 60-53 Lew Wallace. Art Pollard finished with 24 points. With 4:07 remaining, Brian Asbury on the tip. That made it 65-56. Your final is right there, 73-65 in favor of the Lew Wallace Hornets. They are now 10-3. The Rough Riders fall to 12-2. Now elsewhere around the area in basketball, West Side ranked 18th by the UPI, beat Chicago Lindblom. The West Side Cougars are now 11-3. Kenny McLaren had 21 points, 69-52 is your final. 7th ranked Roosevelt beat Wirt tonight 77-61. The Roosevelt Panthers 13-2 on the year. They are 3-1 in the Northwestern Conference. Wirt has yet to win a conference battle. Now over at Highland, Valparaiso picks up their 4th win of the season. The final, the Vikings 47, the Trojans 46. In the Doonlin Conference, 2nd-ranked Michigan City Rogers. No problem with Hobart this evening. Michigan City Rogers is perfect in the Doonlin. They are also perfect on the season. 3-0 and 12-0, 92-69 is your final. We remain in the Doonlin Conference, where Chesterton raises their conference mark to 4-1. The final there was 58-55. That is Doonlin Conference action. Also in the Doonlin tonight, it was Merrillville raising their conference mark to 3-1. Merrillville was led by Mike Meschede's 23 points. The final was 74-57. Now we go over to the Lakeshore Conference. Morton traveled over to Hammond. Hammond High is 10-5 on the year. They're 6-0 in the conference. Neil Collins had 18 points for Hammond High. The final, 79-54 in favor of the Wildcats. Also in the Lakeshore, this ball game in overtime, and I want to thank Paul Loeb for the call. Whiting was led tonight in the losing effort by David Pollock. He had 32 points. For Clark, it was Tim Seaman with 20 points. The final, Clark by 10 over Whiting. We remain in the Lakeshore Conference. Over at East Chicago, Washington, they hit 101 points tonight. Gavitt hit 71. East Chicago had 5 players in double figures. Their first conference win, the final once again, 101-71. Over to the Lake Suburban Conference, where the Crown Point Bulldogs hold on to the conference lead. Eric Juratic had 21 points. They beat Munster by 10. The final was 77 to 67. Now over at Griffith, yes, this is the final. Calumet wins this Lake Suburban Conference battle. The final, Calumet 28, Griffith 27. The Lake Central Indians are red hot. John Lale, who just happens to be a member of our scoreboard crew, popped for 12 points. He grabbed 11 rebounds. Kent Taylor led Lake Central with 22 points and 9 rebounds. Lake Central 3-2 in the conference, 5-8 overall. The final, Lake Central 80, Lowell 57. In the Northwest Hoosier Conference, Kankakee Valley by 4 over Lake Station, 50-46 is your final. North Newton, a loser tonight at home. Rensselaer on top, 73-54. Over in the Porter County Conference, I want to thank Jerry Flood for the phone call. Boone Grove is unbeaten in conference play. They are 13-4 overall. Gary Steinhilber had 15 points tonight for Boone Grove. They win it 77-52. Also in the Porter County Conference, Wheeler is 5-1 in conference play. They win by 1. Chris Moss had 25 points for Wheeler. 76-75 is the final. Morgan Township traveled over to Hanover Central, where they were a winner tonight. 53-32 is your final there. And La Crosse at South Central, we have no score to report to you there. Now over at Winnemac, West Central was a loser tonight by 5, and that final is 59-54. I would like to thank Lou Wallace Athletic Director Bill Kukoy for allowing us to come on over and shoot some of the highlights this evening. Now we take it over to girls basketball, where Hammond High hosted Gary Roosevelt on Monday night. Bill Latour reports on some of the highlights.
Roosevelt's girls basketball team dominated the second half of last Monday night's game against the Hammond High Wildcats to win by a comfortable 11-point margin, 71-60. Hammond kept pace throughout the first half, which ended with a 33-34 score. Hammond was able to do this with a hot hand of their star center, number 22, Siona Wright, who you see here making 2 points. She got 17 points in the first half alone and 27 overall. I asked Coach Harton of Roosevelt what he did to try to stop her.
One person, we didn't know that Siona had hurt us that bad in the middle, but what we were trying to tell them is that everybody's going to have to play defense and we're going to collapse in the middle, help out, and we wanted the guard to come back in front of her so that she wouldn't receive the ball so easily. And they got together and they played defense together, and that may be what shut her down.
The opening of the second half was a much different story. Roosevelt was able to run up 11 unanswered points midway through the third quarter, a lead which they were more or less able to keep all the way to the end of the game. Roosevelt's high scorer was forward number 12, Michelle Jones, who you see here making a nice 15-foot shot, and ended up with 18 points. Behind Michelle was number 15, Millicent Brownrigg, who you see here. She came in off the bench to add another 16 points to the score. With 4:34 left in the game, Hammond went to a full-court press to try to catch up, but Roosevelt handled it well. I asked Coach Harton about this.
It takes 10 seconds. You got 10 seconds to get the ball across the line. And most teams can get it across in 10 seconds, but most teams like to panic and think that they're not going to have no time. So we've been working with them on that, and they executed that well tonight. We didn't turn the ball over as many times as I thought we would.
With this win, Roosevelt's overall record goes to 9-6. For Scoreboard, I'm Bill Latour.
And a slight mistake there on Roosevelt's record. They are now 13-4 on the season. Last night they beat Morton 50-39. Now the girls' sectionals will get underway on Tuesday. Gary Roosevelt will wait till Thursday when they faced Gary Wirt. Now on Wednesday, or last night, Hammond High beat Mann, and that final was 57-48. Hammond High is now 9-7 on the season. Wednesday they will face Bishop Knoll in the Morton sectional. And I guess I should congratulate Couts coach George Davis. His ball club will carry an 18-0 record into Wednesday's sectional contest when they go up against Oregon Davis. And while we are talking about sectionals, 9:30 a.m. is the starting time for the wrestling sectionals, which will get underway at 9 sites around our area tomorrow morning. And now we move over to swimming, and we throw it over to Rich Underwood, who is with tonight's first guest. Rich?
Okay, Bob, thanks a lot. As you may remember from last week's show, we took a closer look at last Saturday's conference wrestling action. Well, tonight we turn our attention to boys swimming as the Lake Suburban and Doolin Conference competition gets underway tomorrow morning at Lake Central and LaPorte. Joining me in the studio tonight is Highland swimming coach Mike Boscovich, and we're going to talk about his 82-83 squad. We're also going to look at the Trojans of the future, and we are going to take a look at tomorrow's conference competition. And Mike, I'd like to welcome you to the show tonight.
Thank you, Rich. Glad to be here.
Well, before we get into your team itself, last night you had a meet against Chesterton, and why don't you give our viewers some highlights of what happened?
Well, It was one of our last toughest meets of the season, and we put some of our sectional lineup together at the meet, and we were really pleased at some of the performances, especially in our two relays. The 200 medley relay time of 142.6 would put us about third in the state right now. And our 400 free relay, which went 322, will give us about sixth place ranking right now. But again, they're just rankings. It's not what we actually would place in the state meet. We had some good individual performances by Jeff Krause in the 100 fly, which moved him up in the rankings, and also Steve Fiegel in the 100-yard freestyle. He did really well there, too.
Okay, Mike, we're taking a look at Tuesday night swimming action against Griffith. You swam mostly freshmen and sophomores in this meet. First of all, why did you do this?
Well, I think swimming is kind of a unique sport. We don't usually lay it on our opponents. We try to, you know, balance it out as much as possible and give them a good run for the money. We try to put our kids into events that will make them competitive. And it helps our kids to compete in other events instead of sticking them in the same event. You know, meet after meet, we move them around, see where they can compete elsewhere.
Now, going into tomorrow's conference, you are 11-2. Now, you told me before we went on, that your team, if you'd have to characterize your team, it would be a lot of balance, and it would be a lot of veterans and a lot of sophomores and juniors. Why don't you give our viewers an insight into your team this year?
Okay, our team's led by two fine seniors, Jerry Scott, our freestyler and distance freestyle, and he's turned into a pretty good sprinter. And Steve Fiegel, a sprinter and a hunter freestyler also, and he's also a member of both relays. They've done a really good job. They've really performed pretty well, and they've led the group pretty well. We have a good, strong junior group also led by Kirk Mustard and Jeff Krause and Ron Pike. They've done a really good job for us too, and we have a really strong nucleus of sophomores. In fact, it's our largest group, and Al Krieger and also we have Ron Kooser in there and Ted Vitamus and Steve King, who have really done a pretty good job this year. And we also have a fairly strong freshman this year, Dan Stuckert.
I know that the varsity squad gets the most attention, but swimming for boys and for girls starts at the sixth grade level, doesn't it?
Well, it could start even sooner than that. We've had, in our age group team, the Highland Hurricane Swim Club, we go down to age six. And we build them up, and we try not to put too much pressure on them, but it gives us a good feeder system into the high school program.
Okay, Mike, just one quick question. We have a big show tonight. Could you tell us about tomorrow's conference competition? I know it's going to come down to Munster. They're trying to win their 10th straight Lake Suburban Conference. How do you see?
Well, Munster definitely has to be the favorite team in the conference meet. We lost to them in a dual meet. It was a close one into the last relay. And I feel that we have stronger swimming events, but they're going to hurt us pretty bad in diving. But if our relays do well enough, we could beat them.
Okay, Mike, it's going to be a wide-open conference competition tomorrow. I'd like to thank you for coming on our show tonight and giving us an insight into your team and the conference coming up tomorrow.
Okay, thanks a lot, Rich. Thanks for inviting me.
It's our pleasure. Bob, it's going to be a wide-open competition tomorrow, and if you're not doing anything, why don't you come on out? And it's going to be good. It's going to be a good one.
Okay, Rich, thanks a lot. And that's a look at swimming tonight here on the Scoreboard Show. Now we switch it over to college basketball, where the Indiana Hoosiers pulled off their third win on the road of this season when they knocked off Northwestern Wednesday night in Alumni Hall. The final was 78-73.
Say what
Here's
you
our
want
report.
About the three-point basket. Northwestern coach Rich Falk loved it in the first half. Behind Art Aaron's three buckets from beyond the stripe, the Wildcats led by as many as nine. But Whitman and Kitchell went to work, and at the half, the Northwestern lead was 2-40-38. Bob Knight went with 7'2" center Uwe Blopp to start the second half. The plan, force it inside to open it up outside for Kitchell and Whitman. Blob responded with three buckets, as did Jimmy Thomas. Indiana put together a run where they outscored the Wildcats 20-10. The Hoosiers led by six, 58-52. Michael Jenkins hit two straight to cut the lead to two, but that's as close as Northwestern would get. Again, Indiana went to their leaders, Randy Whitman, who finished with 25, and Ted Kitchell with the game-high 29. Indiana raises their record to 5-1 in the conference and 15-1 overall. The final from Alumni Hall, Hoosiers 78, Wildcats 73.
And around the Big Ten last night, let's go to the scoreboard. Illinois hit 10 of 13 free throws in the final 4 minutes. Derek Harper, the high point man for the Illini, he had 25 as they beat Michigan State 78-71. Ohio State knocks off 16th-ranked Iowa in double overtime, 89-83. Jim Bullock had two baskets in the third overtime. Purdue in three OTs over Michigan, 80-77. So tomorrow it looks like this. Illinois with a 3-3 conference mark will be at Michigan. 17th-ranked Minnesota will travel to Wisconsin. Indiana, 5-1 in the conference, is at number 16, Iowa. Purdue, 4-2 in Big Ten play, travels over to Michigan State. And Ohio State will be at Northwestern. You know, anybody who follows Indiana University basketball is aware that it's not often that you hear Bob Knight compliment his ball club. Well, following Saturday's 93-76 win over Michigan, Coach Knight did find a few things that pleased him.
You know, a time or two I've been upset because we haven't played as hard, and I thought we were playing pretty hard, and it was a game played back and forth, and then in the second half, I felt that we went out and for about 10 or 11 minutes probably played as well defensively as we've played all year. And that was, to me, the thing that we wanted most out of the game. I felt that we had better guard pressure. I thought that we maintained a defensive positioning that enabled us to come up with the ball as well or better than any time this year. And that's a very, very important thing for us.
Knight was also pleased with the play of number 11, Andrean grad Dan Dockage.
This last week, maybe last 10 days, in fact, Danny has played better than I think he has at any time all year. And he had a knee operation when we got started, and he's about 2 weeks behind by the time, and I don't think he had ever caught up. He's not real quick to begin with. This slows him down a little bit, and I think pressed a little bit. He wasn't handling the ball as well as he was last year. Really wasn't playing as well as he did last year. Now, as I said, this last week to 10 days, he's been much better in practice, and he played about 15 minutes yesterday, and I thought played real well, and I thought did a very good job for us in the first half.
And tomorrow, don't forget, it's second-ranked Indiana at number 16, Iowa. Well, the ladies from Purdue Calumet overcame two obstacles last night. Number one was limited personnel. Number two was a 9-point deficit in the second half. Led by junior Sandy Love, who popped for 16 points after the intermission, the Lady Lakers posted their 7th win of the season, a 68-63 decision over Valparaiso.
The Lady Lakers trailed by 2 at the half, but immediately tied the game at 38 on the jumper from Sandy Love. Valparaiso stormed back with a 13-2 spurt. This bucket by Deb Laddie made the score 51-42 Valparaiso. With just 6 players in uniform, fatigue set in, forcing the Lady Lakers into a zone, a move which proved to be a blessing in disguise.
You know, we didn't want a zone, but we were forced to because of our foul trouble, and it turned out to be the best defense to play.
With Vernell Jackson on the bench with 5 fouls, the Lady Lakers were down to 5 players. That's down but not out. With 4:15 remaining, Brenda Clark hit from the baseline for a 59-58 Purdue lead. Valparaiso moved in front on a couple of free throws, but again, Purdue bounced back on successive 2-pointers from Love and Brenda Clark. The Lady Lakers hit 5 of 6 from the line in the last minute and a half, and that sealed the 68-63 victory. A win that will rank as one of the biggest in the mind of Coach Bill Platt.
Well, our girls have played with heart all year. You know, they don't know when to give up. And we just, you know, keep working and working and scrapping and picking up a loose ball here and in a garbage bucket there. And they just, you know, hang in. They don't think they can lose. Oh, I'm very excited, especially for the girls. This probably has to be our, you know, our biggest win here at Purdue Calumet. Even though we had a super team last year, just as an individual effort, this was, you know, this is the best our girls have played for us since I've been here.
And once again, that final last night, the ladies from Purdue Cal 68, Valparaiso 63. Tomorrow, Purdue Cal travels over to IU Purdue in Fort Wayne. Valparaiso's now 4-5 on the season. They will host Goshen tomorrow. Well, the Purdue Cal men's team was also in the winner's circle last night. They raised their mark to 9-7 with a 76-63 decision over Indiana Tech. And with us tonight is head coach Larry Little. And Larry, before we get to some of the highlights from last night's win, I want to mention to you, now last year you finished off at 8-8. Right now you're 9-7 on the year, but that is a result of you scheduling a little more tougher opponents this year.
Well, I think to some extent, Bob, and I think really honestly in the early part of the year we were not playing very consistently. We had some injuries and we were trying to fit some personnel in and some different people. I think that, along with the fact that we played some better teams away from home, contributed to it, and the kids hung tough and we've bounced back since we've been home and we've been able to win four in a row.
You got off to a slow start in yesterday's game.
Been getting off to a slow start the last couple of games, Bob. I don't know exactly what it is. It's just a matter of not putting the ball in the hole. We have good shots. Our shot selection is not bad. Our patience is not bad. We're just not hitting the basket early in the game. I think it may be a mental thing right now, and it's just, if we ever do that, it's going to make the game a lot easier for us. When we hit early, we won't have to put so much pressure on at the end.
Ed Blackman was your high scorer last year, and of course he's back once again this year. Is he, I don't know if I can use the word leader, is he the leader of your ball club, or is he your man that you look to when you need a basket?
I would say that Ed is a leader. He's developed those characteristics and those traits a lot more this year, Bob, and he's a leader in practice. He's become a little more of a vocal leader. We know that Ed can score and Ed can do the things that other basketball players are unable to do. He's an excellent jumper. He's got very strong hands. And I think that he knows that certain things are expected of him this year, and he looks forward to going out and giving us those things. We have different types of leaders in other situations. Chuck Albrecht has assumed some leadership the last couple of ball games for us that has been very important. Of course, Bernie Millard did those things for us earlier in the year. So we've got players in different positions, but I would say when we look for someone and we need someone, Ed's the one that's going to have to do that for us.
And while we're speaking about Ed Blackman, Clark, what do you say we roll the tape? And we're going to pick up some highlights from last night's win. We start with Ed Blackman here with the jumper. And this here pulled you to 1-8-7. And now we show Daryl McLaren with, I guess, the first rule you teach a kid in basketball, to follow your shot. And he gets the back bucket. Now we're going to take a look at Brandon Adams, who did a good job for you off the bench yesterday.
He really did. He really did. Really.
He fired in at 2 straight and it tied the game at 24. Now we go to your man in the middle, and that's senior Mike Wine.
Mike played one of his better ball games last night.
He gets another bucket here, and you lead 36-35 at the half. And now we'll see some work by two of this year's addition. Mike Sietsma gets the rebound, and Chuck Albrecht gets the bucket, and it's 43-38 in favor of the Lakers. Now Don Seals comes right back down, and your ball club doesn't pick him up, so he pops the jumper, pulls their club within three at 51-48. And Brandon Adams, and that's how you block the shot. Jimmy Pollock near the end of the game here hits one. And the final, once again, was 76-63. But I want to elaborate more right now on some of your additions to this year's ball club. And I guess two of the bigger additions have to probably be Chuck Albrecht and Sietsma. He was all over the court yesterday and one of those type of ball players that isn't afraid to get down on the ground.
This is Mike's third or fourth ball game for us, Bob, and he is that type of player. He comes from that type of program in Kankakee Valley, and he has a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of intensity, and He's like Chuck Albrecht, as you mentioned. They're both not afraid to get their knees on the floor and go after the ball. And we have a number of other players that will do the same thing. And I think that's the thing in this homestand. We've played a little harder. I don't know that we have played great basketball yet. We have played better basketball, and I think we still have a much better basketball ahead of us. But we've played with a higher degree of intensity, and that's been an important thing because we haven't really had that much of a lead. There's been a lot of pressure on us in most of those games, and that's been good, too, because we've been able to score with it meaning an important basket.
Have some of your ball players on the team that saw a lot of playing time last year with the addition of your new players, for example, Curtis Lewis saw a lot of action last year, and yesterday he didn't see too much. How are they all adjusting to the new team?
I think it's been an adjustment, Bob. It's difficult for any young man when you're playing the game of basketball to see somebody else play more than what you're playing, and particularly when you played quite a bit last year. I think that different players give us different things at different times, and I think what we have found is that we're coming up with a chemistry of about 9 or 10 players right now that are doing a lot of things together and doing some things very well. Kurt had some health problems which held him out, and in the time that Kurt was held out, that's when Mike Sietsma came in and did such an excellent job for us. Jimmy Pollock has fought some ankle injuries earlier in the year, and that allowed Chuck Albrecht to come in and do some things. And Tony Vermajohn and Tony Garvey, two other freshmen, have played good ball for us at times to go along with the ball game that Scott Dombrowski played last week against Wabash in the second half. Those are the types of things that we have to have. We're not a star type of team, although Ed is our main player, I should say. But the other kids just have to learn their roles, understand their roles, and do what they're capable of doing and play within themselves. And that's what we've been doing, and that's why we've won these four. Plus being at home, I think, has helped also.
One last question. Through your recruiting, have you found kids are perhaps more wanting to stay closer to home to play basketball now?
Well, I think it's nice that we're able to go in and talk about some things that we accomplished last year and about some things that we're accomplishing this year. I know Coach Linger has been out, and he does a lot of our player contacts. And the first year he told me, he said, you know, Coach, when I would go out, he says, we really didn't have anything to talk about. We were talking about what was going to be. He said, now when you go in, he says, at least you can talk about what was last year and what will definitely be the next year. And that's a little more of a positive nature to take. And I think that we're finding good reception from the coaches and good reception from the players. As you come and see us play, I think they really get their eyes open as to just how competitive and how intense NAIA basketball is. The only difference between that and, say, a Division I program is the fact we don't have the seven-footers in the middle. We have to get by with the 6'7 kids.
Well, Larry, I want to thank you for being with us tonight and wish you good luck tomorrow. You travel over to Aquinas.
Thank you very much, Bob. We appreciate being here, and we've got our work cut out tomorrow at Aquinas.
Okay, the Purdue-Cal Lakers will look for their 10th win of the season tomorrow when they travel over to Aquinas. If you just joined us, right now we're going to run through you what happened tonight in the area of high school basketball, and we will begin right there at Lewallis, the 16th-ranked Hornets over number 9 East Chicago Roosevelt, 73-65. 18th-ranked West Side, 69-52 over Lindblom. 7th-ranked Roosevelt, 77-61 over Wirt. Valparaiso beat Highland by 1. 2nd-ranked Michigan City Rogers, no problem with Hobart. Portage traveled over to Chesterton. The Trojans are a winner by 3. Merrillville, 74, LaPorte, 57. Hammond High, 79-54 over Morton. In overtime, Whiting drops a 10-point decision to Clark, that ball game at Whiting. East Chicago, Washington by 30 over Gavitt. It was Munster losing by 10 tonight. Crown Point's on top, 77-67. Calumet at Griffith, yes, this is a final. Calumet wins it 28-27. Lowell is a loser tonight. Lake Central is your winner. 80-57 is that final. Kankakee Valley by 4 over Lake Station. Rensselaer 73-54, a winner at North Newton. It was Boone Grove at home tonight. They win 77-52. Wheeler and Hebron. Wheeler is on top by 1, 76-75. At Hanover Central, Morgan Township wins this one 53-52. No score to report at South Central, while it was Winnemac, a 59-54 win over West Central. Around the state's top 10, number 3, Newcastle was a winner tonight, as was number 10, Anderson Highland. Well, that's our show for this evening, and once again, I would like to thank Highland swim coach Mike Boscovich and Purdue Cal basketball coach Larry Little for being our guest this evening. Don't forget, this Thursday at 6:30, it's Wisconsin at Indiana, and you'll see that one right here on Channel 50. Thanks for joining us tonight, and we'll see you all next week.
The preceding Channel 50 sports presentation was funded in part through a grant from Gillespie Ford in Gary.